Muthuswami Dikshitar was a Sanskrit scholar, and he brought his scholarship to bear upon his compositions as well. In many of his compositions, we can see that scholarship glistening. It's almost as if it's his love for the language, for Sanskrit, and how he marries that with his love for music. If you find emotional richness in Tyagaraja, we find this linguistic incorporating the richness of Sanskrit language into musical compositions. We find this in Dikshitar. For instance, Dikshitar has composed many groups of what is called Vibhakti Kritis. Now, Vibhakti, for those of you who are exposed to any bit of Sanskrit, Vibhakti is how nouns are declined in Sanskrit. This is a very basic fundamental grammatical principle. A noun can take on any case in a sentence, or various cases in a sentence. For instance, if I say Rama comes, Rama is the doer, he is in the nominative case. He is a person who performs the action, so Rama comes. If I say I see Rama, here Rama, the noun, is in the position of the object. This is an accusative case. And so on, I could say, for instance, this is Rama's book, in which case this is what is called genitive. It is Rama's book. So every noun can take on any of 8 cases according to Sanskrit grammar. And Dikshitar has composed many sets of compositions in praise of various deities, and he has composed them in all the Vibhaktis. So for instance, taking the god Lord Tyagaraja of Thiruvarur, we have the Tyagaraja Vibhakti Kritis. So he has sung one composition in the nominative case, second in the accusative case, and so on till 8 compositions. Now, not only in praise of Tyagaraja, Kamalamba Vibhakti Kritis, what is called the Kamalamba Navavaranam, is an extremely famous set of Kritis. We have Abhyamba Kritis, Nilotpalamba Kritis, Guru Guha Vibhakti Kritis, Rama also, Shri Rama Vibhakti Kritis we have. So, this is something he has, obviously he has taken great pleasure in bringing his Sanskrit scholarship, his love for Sanskrit into his compositional endeavors. So, if you take a look at this set of compositions, these are the Guru Guha Vibhakti Kritis. We can see there are 8 Kritis here. The first Vibhakti, Srinathadi Guru Guho Jayati Jayati. The second is Manasa Guru Guha Rupam Bhajare. This is when it's an object, it's the accusative. Shri Guruna Palitosmi. This is an instrumental case. Guru Guhaya Bhaktanugrahaya. This is the fourth case. Then Guru Guhad Anyam Najaneham. This is the fifth case. Then Shri Guru Guhasya Dasoham. This is the sixth case. Shri Guru Guha Swamini. This is the seventh. And finally, we have Shri Guru Guha Murte, Chit Shakti Sphurte. This is how these compositions have begin, this set of Vibhakti Kritis. Now, this, the first composition in this group, Shri Nathadi Guru Guho Jayati Jayati. Much has been said about this composition. It is believed to have been the first ever composition that Dikshitar composed, and it goes like this.
Srinathadi
Guru Guha Jayati Jayati Srinakadi Guru Guha Jayati Jayati Srinakadi. So this is in the Ragamaya Malavagola, which as you all know is the, it's the first raga that a beginner is taught, and the Aroha Avroha is incorporated into this composition right in the beginning. So it's like this. Sai Gama Srinathadi Guru Guha Padhani Sa Nidapamagari Sa Sari Gama Padhani Sa Nidapamagari Srinathadi Guru Guha Jayati Jayati Shri. You have the first, second and the third speeds incorporated into the very first avartana of the composition. And textually also there are many references to Advaita. As we will see, Dikshidhar was an Advaitin. Advaita Vedanta being one of the a philosophical, metaphysical stance. It's a path, it's a spiritual path. Advaita Vedanta is not just a metaphysical stance, it's also a spiritual path. And Dikshidhar was very much an Advaitin. And in this composition, we have many references to Advaita. We have references to Mantra Shastra, Tantra, and Sri Vidya worship also. To really appreciate Dikshidhar's compositions in their fullness, one needs to have a knowledge of all these esoteric disciplines. But even without them, just the sound of the compositions themselves have a certain grandeur about it, can instill an awe in the listener. Now Advaita, if we talk of Dikshidhar's compositions, we have to mention Advaita. And Advaita is, as I said, it is a school of philosophy, of metaphysics, that was first propounded by Adi Shankaracharya. And more than anything, it is a spiritual path, and many Hindus adhere to its tenets. And it's a very complex metaphysic, it's a very complex philosophy, but it's usually summarized in three lines: Brahma Satyam, Jagan Mithya, Jeevo Brahma Iva Na Paraha. That is Brahman, there is one ultimate, it's a relentless, unrelenting monism, which says that the ultimate reality is one, is a single principle. And all that we see, we experience, all these differences, all these experience which is grounded on differentiating oneself from the not oneself. This is unreal. This is Jagan Mithya. The world is unreal. Brahman is true. Jagan Mithya. The world is unreal. Jeevo Brahma Eva. That is, every individual soul is Brahman. So, and that is also the purport of the very famous Upanishadic statement, Tattvamasi. That Brahman is you. And there is no difference. So, it's a highly, highly complex and it's a philosophical system that has had many that you have many texts on, many proponents of it, many people have debated against and for it. It's a complex system. And in Dikshidhar's compositions, you have many concepts, ideas that belong to the Advaitic tradition woven into the compositions themselves. Now if the world is unreal, and if the ultimate reality is a single differenceless principle, undifferentiated principle, then why is it that we experience all this? The Advaitic explanation for this is Maya. So it is Maya, a veil of ignorance that covers the individual soul, which is why it sees so many things as different from it, and we experience the world. So Maya again is an incredibly complex and interesting concept, and Dikshidhar's composition on this is perhaps captures it as best as it can be. The Maya is the veil of ignorance, but Maya is also the reason that we are able to worship the Lord, because Maya is the reason for the Lord also. Even Ishvara is a creation of Maya. So in this composition, Maye Tvam Yahi. So first Dikshidhar says, Maye Tvam Yahi, go away. And then he says, Mampahi. So he says, Maye Tvam Yahi, Mam Badhitum Kahi. Why do you disturb me? Maya, you go away. Why do you disturb me? But immediately in the Anupallavi, he says, Dhyaye Dhyaye Tvamehi Mudandehi Mampahi. But you are what I have to meditate on. And now you come, give me joy and protect me. Even the goddess is Maya. So this kind of paradox that lies in the heart of Advaita, which is captured in the concept of Maya, Dikshidhar sings about it. I will just sing the first line of it. The rest of it you can hear it rendered on the violin. Maya.
Yeah.
might say that the complexity of the concept of Maya, the intrinsic paradox of Advaita Vedanta, is captured magnificently in this small, it's a very small composition. Maya is the reason for ignorance, so she has to go away for knowledge to arise, which knowledge is liberation according to Advaita Vedanta. And yet it is she who is worshipped, she who is meditated upon, and she who is a giver of boons. It's only in the jagat, which is mithya, that is, which is illusory, the world which is illusory, only in this world is the worshipped and the worshipper real. In the realm of Brahman, ultimate reality, that is a differenceless principle. There is nothing apart from it. As Dikshitar again says in another composition of his, Nirvishesha Chaitanya Rupini. It is the principle, that ultimate principle is of the nature of sheer differenceless consciousness, what we also call Satchidananda. In Advaita Vedanta, a seeker of Brahman, a seeker after liberation, seeks knowledge, and he must seek out a guru for that, a teacher who can impart that knowledge to him. But yet, this knowledge is not something that can be imparted. How can you talk about Brahman? As the Keno Upanishad says, one of the ancient Upanishads, the Keno Upanishad, it says that principle, Brahman, is whence words return. Words cannot reach it. The mind cannot reach it. It cannot attain them. The words or the mind cannot attain Brahman. So, we have the concept of Dakshinamurti, a deity, who is the guru, who imparts Advaitic learning, and he imparts it through silence. Mauna Vyakhyana, as it is called. And this is Dakshinamurti, and Dikshitar has composed a grand composition on Dakshinamurti, Indiraga Shankarabharanam. In the Pallavi itself, as you can see, he says, Dakshinamurte Vidalita Dasarte Chidananda Purte Sada Mauna Kirte. So he is famed for his Mauna Vyakhyana, for his teaching through silence. The Charanam has many concepts connected with Advaita Vedanta. Nikhila Samshaya Harana Nipunatara Yukte Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Well, this is the state of Brahma realization. When you realize Brahman, that is Nirvikalpa. There is no Vikalpa, is distortion or any thing that, for instance, Savikalpa, there is all our experiences Savikalpa. That if you see anything, the consciousness gets distorted, it gets an image, and that is Savikalpa. Nirvikalpa Samadhi is a state of liberation. Nirvikalpa Samadhi, that is one thing. Aparoksha Nitya Bodha Ananda Mukte, again, that is a profound Advaitic concept. That this knowledge of Brahman is aparoksha, that is, it is without any mediation. Svajnana Nivritti, that is, Svanubhoga Tripti, that is, you revel in your own, or in the joy in yourself. Because the Brahman is supposed to be of the nature of Sat Chit and Ananda. Joy is the sense of Brahman. So these extremely esoteric concepts, they are all woven very easily into a composition like this. That is Dikshitar for you.
Nikhila samshaya.
Every